Weapon Group Medium. In November of the same year, it was reclassified as Bombardment Group Heavy. The first squadrons were the 14th, 26th, and 42nd, later followed by the 98th and the 431st when the 14th was sent to the Philippines. The squadron was originally equipped with B-18s, later B-17s, and finally B-24s to finish the war. In 1939, Hitler launched an attack against Poland, which began World War II.
America realized that World War II was on the way and drafted millions of young men who went to various camps all over the United States for training. Many of the former members of the 11th Group in this audience went through these training exercises and tests and remember them well. There was need for mechanics of all types, engine, airframe, and other specialties. And of course, we could not get along without cooks, radio operators, bombardiers, armorers, meteorologists, and the 101 other specialties that make up a modern Air Force. Each was indispensable in the team. Both Germany and Japan were on the march in Europe and in the Far East. Meanwhile, the American troops trained with obsolete equipment or no equipment at all. This is peaceful Waikiki Beach and Honolulu in December 1941. In the mainland at Hamilton Field, 14 B-17 aircraft were taking off to fly to the Philippines after a stop in Hawaii. Since this was a 2,400-mile flight, no armament was carried. About this time, north and east of the island of Oahu, the Japanese aircraft carriers were launching their planes that fateful Sunday morning. These planes were directed to strike fleet, land, and air activities of the United States at Pearl Harbor, Pickham, Wheeler, and other areas on the island. B-17s actually flew into the middle of this Pearl Harbor attack and were dispersed to various fields around the islands. These are captured Japanese pictures, those taken from the air, and of course those on the ground were from our own news media. Many of the B-17s flying in from Hamilton Field were assigned to the 11th Bomb Group, Pearl Harbor, Hickam, Wheeler, and other installations on the island were a shambles after the two major attacks by the Japanese air fleet. It is significant to read a part of the report by General Marshall to the President of the United States after the Pearl Harbor attack. He says, the air forces in the Pacific were built up piecemeal on the skeleton of the 11th Bombardment Group in Hawaii and the 19th Bombardment Group, which moved into Australia from the Philippines. It is very obvious that the 11th Bombardment Group was the first unit struck during the war and eventually carried the war to the enemy. Later in 1942, in May, all units in the Hawaiian Islands were placed on special alert as the Japanese naval code had been broken. It was determined that the Japanese were to strike either at Hawaii or Midway. The planners decided that the first blow would fall at Midway. This segment of this film is from the Navy film, The Battle of Midway. The B-17s shown in this segment are from the 5th Bomb Group and the 11th Bomb Group. Note on the insignia on the aircraft that the red center of the star insignia has been painted over white. Here are the men putting in the extra bomb bay tanks for the long search missions. As these B-17s take off, if you will note carefully, you will see behind them several B-24s, which were at Midway to make a diversionary strike at Wake Island. General Tinker and two other pilots took these B-24 aircraft on missions to Wake. General Tinker's plane crashed, however, and the other two planes turned back. General Tinker was never found. Later in the month, however, several B-24s did stage out of Midway and attack Wake Island. While Midway is considered primarily a naval and air battle, there was considerable damage done at Midway itself by attacking Japanese fighters and bombers. These scenes are actually scenes taken at the time of the battle.
The 11th Group flew 55 plane sorties, shot down 10 Zeros, and lost two of their own B-17s from the time they were there on May 20th to begin sea searches during the battle, June 3rd to June 6th, and also sea searches later until June 10th, 1942.
Incidentally, there was considerable arguments between the Navy and the Air Corps after the battle, and several fist fights broke out in downtown Honolulu between partisans of the various services. This is typical of the competitive services and all services combined to make this a significant victory. Meanwhile, in the Southwest Pacific, the United States was getting ready to launch the first land assault in that area, the assault against Guadalcanal. From July 1942, first offensive action of the Pacific War. The squadrons of the 11th Bomb Group were originally situated at Nandi, Ifade, and New Caledonia. They then moved up to Espirito Santo and staged into Guadalcanal itself at Henderson Field. By using Henderson Field as a staging area, the planes were able to refuel and rearm and did range far into the Northern Solomons. The living conditions at the time of this battle were quite primitive. It is estimated that 80% of the members of the 11th Bombardment Group contracted malaria, and 100% of the men had dengue fever. One of the four squadrons had 165 men in the hospital at one time. The targets hit during these operations by the 11th Bombardment Group included the Lunga Point Airfield, which later became Henderson Field, Gavatu, additional targets on Guadalcanal, Tulagi, Savo, Raketa Bay, Gizo, many naval engagements in the slot, particularly against the Tokyo Express, which would come down the slot periodically. Also hitting Buin, Shortland, Fasai, Bougainville, and Vella Lavella. The group lost 24 of its 40 aircraft. It did, however, shoot down or destroy on the ground 124 Japanese aircraft, damaged 57 Japanese aircraft, sank four ships, damaged 15, and probably damaged 9 others. For this great effort, the 11th Bombardment Group received the Distinguished Unit Citation as follows. The 11th Bombardment Group from July 31st to November 30th, 1942, continually attacked superior Japanese air units during the enemy attempt to gain a stronger foothold in the Solomon Islands. It inflicted heavy damage upon enemy airfields, storage and supply areas, seaplane bases, troop positions, and other installations. Sank four Japanese ships, damaged 15 more, and probably damaged 9 others. During these operations, the 11th faced and solved extremely difficult problems of logistics and made long, hazardous overwater flights to reach enemy objectives, which frequently were located at the extreme flying range of its airplanes. There is another written record of this era, which we believe probably describes the activities of the group in at least as vivid detail as the Distinguished Unit Citation. This is known as the Talking Blues and was written by some poor dog face while he was sweating out his furlough home. Back in Wahoo in 42, Eager Beavers, me and you. Guadalcanal, 43, Reluctant Dragons, you and me. Espirito Santo, Fiji and all, were behind it, the big eight ball. Lizards, flies, mosquitoes too, corned beef hash and GI stew. 800 miles out to sea, started to sweat that number three. That goes out, we come down. Nothing but ocean all around. Here I sit, tear in my eye, tired of living, too young to die. Going to Auckland pretty soon, Get me a woman and howl at the moon. Striking force, out to sea. Sighted transport, him or me. We made our run, AA got rough. On the way home, zeros got tough. Pilots can fly, gunners can gun. Bombardier's busy during the run. Navigator's got a gun, he shoots too. Damn co-pilots got nothing to do. Up at Buca the other day, 15 zeros came out to play. Down in the turret, both guns jammed, started to see that promised land. 6 months of action, where's my relief? Sweating each mission may end in grief. Waiting for a ship that never comes in. Waiting for a chance to go and sin. If I get back, no more I'll roam. I'll see my woman and stay at home. Don't give a damn what you people do, but boy, my flying days are through. That tells it all. There is little to be added to the plaintive wail. The air war in the South Pacific wasn't the boys' idea of how to spend a nice holiday. The 11th Group was finally relieved in March of 1943 and returned to Oahu, where most of the men chose to take reassignment rather than return to the group. Most of the line chiefs, the crew chiefs, and other of the top sergeant personnel did take furloughs and return to the group. This was indeed fortunate, as it gave the new team a chance to be indoctrinated by experienced men. After returning to Oahu, the 11th Group was re-equipped with B-24 aircraft. This aircraft was better suited for the long, arduous missions of the Central Pacific, which were to come. It had a longer range than the B-17, could carry a larger bomb, slightly faster than the B-17. Its main strong point, however, was its longer range. The missions in the Central Pacific, which were flown by the B-24s, averaged 2.5 times the length of the missions flown by the 8th Air Force in Europe. At the beginning of this period, the planes of the 11th Bomb Group were flying 12 and 14 hour missions in their aircraft. During June and July, the group retrained with an almost completely new group of men. They carried on significant strikes against the Gilberts and the Marshalls, staging through Funafuti in the Ellice Islands. In July, a raid was made on Wake Island, staging out of Midway. In September, the group planes again staged out of Funafuti against the Gilberts and the Marshalls. This aircraft is Little Audrey of the 431st Bomb Squadron of the 11th Group. Before it returned to the States, it had 100 missions from the Gilberts all the way to Iwo Jima. It flew 225,000 combat miles, lugged 417,000 pounds of bombs, was hit by flak 75 times, had no members of its several crews killed, had 10 engines and 2 hydraulic systems. This plane taxiing by would probably raise a chuckle for the B-17 men, I'm sure. The 11th Group moved into the Alise Islands in November of 1943, 2 squadrons going to Funafuti, 1 to Canton Island, and 1 to Nuku'alofa'a. The group made strikes against the Gilberts and ranged far into the Marshalls on very long missions. After Tarawa was taken, the group moved to Tarawa and struck further into the Marshalls to strike Eniwetok, Malayalap, Kwajalein, Macon, Jolyuat, Millie, Nauru, Tarawa, and Apamama. The main purpose was to neutralize these islands to keep them from being used by the Japanese as bomber and fighter staging bases. After the assault in the Marshalls against Kwajalein, the 11th Group squadrons moved to Kwajalein and again ranged far out into the Carolines and into the Marianas, striking as far as Saipan and Guam. The general pattern at this time was to hit various airfield islands of the Japanese to keep them neutralized, as indicated a few moments ago, and to soften up the atolls which were to be invaded. Then the group would move to one of the invaded islands and start the process all over again. The targets from Kwajalein were Wochi, Marcus, Yap, Eniwetok, Wake, Panape, Husai, Nauru, Ocean, Malayalap, Millie, Jolyuat, Rongelap, Likep, Wowalai, Ulithi, Palau, and of course the so-called impregnable bastion at Truk. This is a pretty good landing, all of you pilots, if you remember. I would say that pilot receives A for effort. It might be interesting to note at this time that the 7th Air Force operated over an area of 16 million square miles. This is 5 times the size of the continental United States, excluding Alaska. Just so you don't think there was no fighter opposition and flak, you can take a look at these pictures. Those are phosphorus bombs dropped by Japanese fighters. After Eniwetok was taken, the 11th Group staged out of Eniwetok on into the Marianas and conducted significant strikes against Guam and Saipan and Tinian. Some of these islands from the air look like beauty spots, but I can assure you they were not, as all of you who were there know. That yellow B-26 back there is a target tow plane. These are 500 pounders waiting to be loaded onto a 24. Notice the informality of dress. It is apparent that there was not too much dress discipline at this stage of the game. Some of you probably remember the award ceremonies, and here, of course, full dress was the order of the day. Shake hands with the general, son. These fellows are evidently posing for pictures for the people back home. These shots are the officers' quarters of the 11th group on Kwajalein. And of course, we mustn't forget the windmill laundry, since there was always a wind coming off of the lagoon to offer power to clean up our dirty underwear. I'm sure you know what that building is. Here's the library. This fellow is fixing some of the plexiglass that was damaged by a phosphorus bomb dropped by a Japanese fighter. This next section is the briefing before the wake raid of July 11, 1944. Now, this is the intelligence officer. He is telling the assembled pilots that the ACAC will be non-existent, the fighters will not take off, and everything will come out just fine. This next segment is the move from Kwajalein to Guam by the 98th Squadron. Now, this section is quite lengthy. And it probably will be quite boring, but all of those of you who were on this trip remember just how boring the real trip was. Notice how well organized everything is. Nobody has to wait. All they do is just step right up and take their turn. Many of the members of the 11th group spent more time on the water than men in the Navy. Many of our men spent 90 to 100 days on the water during their 11th group service days. Notice how everyone is traveling light. You may remember that quaint expression. Ah, for the pleasures of a Pacific cruise. Nothing to do but sit around and play cards all day, except when you were on KP and chipping paint off the deck. Here are some of the fellows playing. Whoopsie doopsie. Now here's a fellow dreaming about Hawaii. So we bid a fond farewell to Cape Mendocino.
Boo!
Bah! Bah! There's one fellow who will come up there with a mattress under his arm. See if you can pick him out there. There he is. He believes in comfort all the way. I wonder who he liberated that mattress from. What officer's barracks? Again, notice the tremendous organization. Everyone knows exactly his place and how he's going to get there. But while we're waiting, we might as well have a little game of galloping dominoes. After all, the money isn't worth anything anyway. You might as well use it to gamble with. Sergeant always told me never to let anyone shoot dice without banking it off of a board. I guess these fellas never learned that lesson. Here's our stalwart old friend, the 6x6. How many miles have you ridden in that monster? This is the strip at Harmon Field on Guam. All four squadrons were located here. However, when they first arrived at the island, they were up at the Agana Naval Airfield up on top of the hill. The Navy kicked us out, so we went down to what we originally called Depot Field, and then it was renamed Harmon Field after General Harmon was lost in the Pacific on a plane flight. Now, when we reached Guam, activity really speeded up considerably. Of course, Iwo Jima was a prime target, as well as Haha Jima, Chichi Jima, Yap, Marcus, Annie Jima, Pagan, and of course, Truck. Hey, how did that wreck get in there? That's a B-29, isn't it? Oh yes, there it is. Our beloved allies. You fellows may recall that no one was permitted to go near the B-29s without a special pass. It is said that one of the crew chiefs of the 11th group put a sign in front of his B-24 that said, "Visitors welcome, no pass required." This is a view all of you ground pounders had. You can almost hear the hydraulic system squeaking when the brakes are applied. Now this next series of scenes is the 42nd area. Just to refresh your memory, the 42nd took a tremendously bad beating on Funafuti, losing a great number of their crews and planes. When the rest of the group moved to Tarawa, the 42nd was stripped of a number of men to bring the other squadrons up to TO strength. The balance of the 42nd returned to Wahoo to re-equip and retrain. They were sent to Guam about a month prior to the rest of the group coming in from Kwajalein. Their prime job was to set up the various areas, to police the areas, and to get things ready for the rest of the group. At that time, the Japanese were still holding out on Guam, and guard duty was extremely hazardous. There were a number of Jap snipers and infiltrators still in the area. The men were put on work details almost continually, and they were pulling guard duty every second night. One of the blessings of Guam was the readily available supply of coral, which was used for tent floors, roads, and so forth. It was brought in on dump trucks and dumped in various sections of the area and was distributed manually by the troops. After laying out a coral floor, the tents were then erected over the floor. The mud at this time was almost shin deep. Now, I hope this 11th group member's wife will see this someday. He's probably always complained to her about the fact that she doesn't do his washing very well. And if she sees this, she can spike him right now. These, I believe, are his undergarments.
Okay.
comes Santa Claus. You know who I think that is behind that white beard? I think that's Ralph Schneff. He's a very active member of our association. Hi, Ralph. My, oh my, everybody gets a present. Ralph can really read those names quickly, can't he, the way he's passing those out. I have a sneaking suspicion that this was posed. In other words, I think he's a great big phony. I don't think that beard is a real beard either. Now here's Ralph as we knew him. Handing out the mail every day. This is rather pathetic, really. You'll note some of these men do not receive any mail at all. And I'm sure all of you remember those days when nothing came through. I can assure you that Ralph and the other mail clerks were very, very disappointed also. This is a cut out of a South Sea Island motion picture of the swaying palms. A little later, they were able to get wooden frames for tents. Now this is an 11th group mission up to Chichi. Note the radar bomb sight sticking down in the front of the plane there. This bombing was done through clouds. Since most of these bombs appear to be falling in the water, I would presume this was a strike against shipping. Actually, Chichijima had a harbor known as Futami Ko, which was a large Japanese fleet anchorage in the Bonin Islands. A great number of the strikes were against shipping in this bay, Futami Ko. This was the main Japanese anchorage in the Bonin Islands. Later, the 11th group dropped mines furnished by the Navy in Futami Ko, and the Navy indicated that very little shipping was in this harbor after the mining missions were completed. The mining missions were in two series known as Mike and Mike Jr. and were considered highly successful. About 85% of all mines were laid in the assigned areas. calling card from the defenders below. There again is an evidence of the strike against shipping. The section just before this and the section following show a raid on Iwo Jima. The 11th group hit Iwo Jima 79 straight days and nights prior to the invasion by the Marines. Many of these raids were single plane raids with delayed action bombs. Others were squadron force and group force raids. In fact, the 11th group hit the invasion beaches about 5 minutes before the Marines landed. The background music I am playing now is called Sky Symphony. This was written for the motion picture Strategic Air Command, which was about a B-36 unit right after World War II. The B-36 unit used in this motion picture was the 11th Bombardment Group. We also distributed leaflets asking the Japanese to surrender. These are flags issued to the men in case they were shot down over China. This gave the Chinese instructions as to how to take care of the men to evade Japanese capture. This particular segment is taking off from Yantan Airfield on Okinawa. It's a little out of sequence, but it's a joint raid on Shanghai by the 494th and the 11th Group, and you'll tell by the tail markings that all four squadrons of the 11th, as well as the four squadrons of the 494th, are represented in this particular raid. Actually, when we hit Okinawa, we began to hit the big time. This was where we pulled not squadron missions anymore, but multi-group missions. At one time, there were 400 B-24 and B-25 planes hit Shanghai's Chiangwan Air Force Base of the Japanese in one raid. This will remind you that the Pacific War was primarily a Navy show, the Air Corps being merely a supporting unit. The Japanese targets hit from Okinawa by the 11th Group were Suiki Airfield, Kurami Airfield, Yusa Airfield, Iwakuni Airfield, the battleship Haruna, which was sunk by the 11th Group, according to the United States Navy, Miho Airfield, Matsuyama, Sasebo, Nagasaki, Omuta, Nobioka, Kumamoto, Sadahara, Miyazaki, Aburuatsu, Taramizu, Kagoshima, Akaya, Omatu, Izumi, Wakimoto, and in China, the airfields at Lungpua and Qianwan, and also the airfield at Qinghai, all of these near Shanghai. The last raid by the 11th Group was August 12, 1940.